some stuff you wouldn't normally go there, you wouldn't normally like. So that was my goal. I hope that works. I hope in this way you can feel what it feels like to be a world finals, or the easy problems are done. If there are easy problems, they are done rather fast. And then you have a lot of problems you don't know how to solve, and you wouldn't like to go if you knew how to solve them, so they are kind of you should try to start solving problems that are harder and harder. And in order to do that, you don't have to get distracted by easier problems. Okay? So that's one comment I wanted to make. The next comment is about today. So today I'm going to talk about hashing and string algorithms using hashing. So those of you who were here last year, I'm sorry, you probably have some repeated stuff. Maybe if I wasn't here enough last time, then you can ask questions held up for like a year ago. Anyway, for those who are new to this, I hope this gives you another perspective on how you can solve string problems. And I'm not saying it's the only way, I'm saying it's a good way, or a decent way, what you consider. So in order to force you to try and use it at least once in your life, today I asked for some individual contest. So you have access to a single computer per person. So to be here, that does not mean we need to like stay there in your computer and not talk with anyone and do everything by yourself. On the contrary, the idea is everyone has the right to a computer, so everyone can code, and you can still talk to your teammates, or you can still talk to anyone else you like. My intention is that at some point you sit down in a computer and try to code something, if you can, using the stuff I'm going to talk about today. So, if you do that, then you get more familiar with these techniques, you'll have questions you didn't think about during class. And for me, I think the only way to really understand the technique is to use it and really code something with it and then see if it works or not. Okay, so my goal is try to use it yourself, code it even if you don't like it. And someone else in your team is going to do it, try to do it yourself once so that you know what it can do and what it can't. Okay? Now, of course, if you don't want to follow my advice, you already think that it's alright. As I was saying, you can talk with your teammates, you can discuss with them or with anyone else. During the contests, like also outside, like, doing problems or something, just walking around, so you can come with them. With me, I try not to give away the problem solution, but help sort of like a teammate help force me and give the solution. Try not to force me. Because I'm doing this today, this individual contest, we have three groups, so you have a little space. Those who were here last year, remember I had, in a similar fashion, I had a problem I meant to be working towards last time. So that was a problem I found, it's a bit harder, and if you do it, it means you're really grasping the concept I'm trying to throw at you. So you solved that problem, you got 2 points last time. Nobody solved that problem last time. I was a bit sad, so today I'm going to have the reward for today. There's 2 problems, and they are not worth an extra point, they are worth a pizza. So now, later today we have pizza, so whoever solves that problem gets a pizza for themselves. Let's see if it works better than so I'm going to give you the problem that are worth the points. Later on, before the contest, or just after the contest begins, I think it will be clear anyway. So,
try to.
I mean, the pizza is for you to try it and go. Right? If you get a wrong answer, you need some pizza anyway. Try to go with it and think of it as a nice reward. Not being a word final, be a reward. You get a pizza.
Say to the natural number.
equipment. So if I can do this, I have this function, takes a string, gives me a number, I then compare my numbers, and that's like compare my strings. If this is a one-to-one map, exactly the same. And then I have my O1 transformed into an O1. So how can I do this? If it keeps the order, then I will have this order, because I will only have it if it's both ways. So I'm going to actually present the function that can do this and show you that, well, you can actually keep this string, for instance. Okay? So what you can keep is if you want to map a string to a number, and you have some alphabet, let's say here the characters are some alphabet. Characters size k. My characters are 0. Okay? So I have an alphabet of k characters. I can think of those characters as the digits of a base k number, right? So instead of thinking of this as a string, I will think these as digits of a number. That's what my hashing function in principle would be. So I just need a map from strings to numbers. I say, just read this as you would read a base k number. So that would mean h of some string s is just take the first character, a 0, and take k to the size of n minus 1, plus, so on, plus, when you get x, n minus 1, you get k. Okay? So this is the base. The character on the leftmost goes with the highest power. The right most, the lowest power. Okay? So say we're dealing with the alphabet of lowercase English letters, K, this is A to Z, K would be in both examples would be 26. So this is a base 26 number. And this is a mapping function that maps strings to numbers, and it has this property. But it keeps strings that compare, let's do lexicographically, it maps them to numbers that compare let's do as numbers, okay? As long as I'm dealing with strings of the same length. Okay.
Isn't the mapping O(n)?
Okay, so this hashing function will have many problems. This is the first idea I get. I do this, I have my hashing function, I can compare numbers. But as you said, you have problems here. Let me make a short list of the problems. First, I think I mentioned, well, I did mention it sort of keeps this property. I mentioned it's obviously the Amiga graph. I mean, this is two ways. There's a one-to-one relation from the string to the number. It's easy to define and it would be easy to implement. Those are the advantages. Now to the disadvantages. So, first disadvantage, as you said, this seems to be O(n) to characters. So, my goal was, I have A, I have B. If I compare here, so, I wanted to use a map, apply h, and get a number, get h of b, and get a number here, and then compare here. And this is fast. But the problem is here is low, and here is low. So I didn't win much in terms of if I want to do the map and then compare that doing the map is good. So at first it looks like I haven't won anything. Because one is just that. I still don't know when to tell you. Another problem is if I ever deal with hashes of strings of different lengths, then this is not very important anymore. Okay? So whenever I have, for instance, one way of choosing this, I mean here I'm thinking of them as digits. In general I would have some value assigned to each character in my alphabet. Okay? If some of these values, so I have a V of C, and for each character gives me the digit it corresponds to. So if one of these is a zero, then compare it, for instance, if A maps to zero, then compare it the string AA to the string A, they both match to zero, and they're different because they have different lengths. Okay? So different lengths would be a problem. That's another problem. And there are more. The most obvious one is it's also a line and comparison. Okay? Because if you look at this, you get rather high powers for even short string. You get rather high powers of the base. Okay? So this number grows really quickly. So for instance, let's say take here 12 digit string or 12 character string, it becomes a 12 digit number in base 26, and then that number is way beyond what you would put in a lockdown or a signed lockdown. And the problem there is you cannot compare, or you cannot store them, you have to store them separately and compare yourself. So this function has many, as I said, many problems. Problems when strings are of different lengths, problems of numbers getting too big, problems of you have to calculate stuff beforehand and it's slow, and we have to fix those, but we have to give up either way. So it's early to give up, I have like an hour early. So I give up it. Right now I'm going to fix some of these problems, okay? To fix problems, normally what you do is you take your assumptions and you start seeing what you can change in your assumptions. So the main way you work, I know that this is math or physics, you take your assumptions, you see some of them, some constraints you have, and then you try to relax those constraints, and those constraints that are relaxed give more flexibility to your tools. Okay? You relax a constraint, you get more flexibility, and that flexibility gives the tool more power. Okay? So, as I said, my hashing function was that, because I wanted to compare stuff. And I wanted to keep some of this stuff. So, if I'm willing to just not keep it, you're welcome to apply, but let's say I'm first willing to say, okay, I'm going to relax some of the assumptions here and see what happens. So then what I can do is relax here. So this is what we are going to relax. So technically, this is a perfect hash function that works imperfect. Okay? Perfect because it maps, it's a one-to-one thing, and it's nice, and all, it's easy, but it works. It does not work for what we want. So we're going to relax this constraint. We're going to make a hash function that takes a string to a number, and there's no way out. Okay? So once I relax here, there's no way of, let's say I give you a hash, there's no way you're going to get your string again. Take your hash function, forget your string, you're done. Never come back asking for my string. Give the hash function, and that's all you get. Okay? So you have to be willing to give up coming back. What happens if you're willing to give up that? You get flexibility in the way you define a hash function. Okay? So I'm just going to go ahead and give you a hash function you can use based on this one, but now knowing that there's really no need to have a one-to-one correspondence. So what I'm going to do first is take this on somehow. Okay? And because I know don't really need these numbers to mean anything. Before they represented digits in a base k number, but now if I take this mod here and I forget about this k, there's no more digits around. So I can put some base d everywhere and just say I have the freedom to choose d and also the value for each character in my function. So I relaxed this condition. This allows me to take a function like this. This is not the only function I can take, but I will use it as an example, and I can think of others, or you can browse online for that. But what has changed here? The most obvious change is now this modem is doing weird stuff. This modem will take many strings. To the same, any multiple of n is subtracted from this number. So I can get a lot of strings that match to the same. All the strings that are the same on n in this hash will hash to the same value, and I will not be able to distinguish them. Okay? So effectively, what I'm doing here is actually using this one. Okay? So I lost my one-to-one correspondence, I'm using this. Is it clear? So, I don't know how comfortable you feel with that. It would seem it defeats the purpose. Okay? It would seem it just means you're not going to do anything anymore. So, what I'm going to do now is try to fix all the problems I've created by introducing. Okay, so let's say the first thing I'm going to fix or I'm going to deal with is this sign, the equal sign. So for now I'd say the comparison. If these numbers are called n, this also changes the order. It means you're not going to get a less than or a greater than operator. That's not going to work. So let's say, what can I do with equal? Okay. Some of the nice properties I had before are still there. I can calculate this rather easily. It's easily defined. I have fixed a problem right away. I mean, if this m is small enough, and I can make it as small as I want because it's arbitrary, then if this m is small enough, my numbers will not get big ever. They just. My hashes now go in the range. I mean, they take a string, they give me something in the range 0 to n. Okay? So if m is sort of small, I can store that in an unsigned number. Okay, and so I fixed one problem, but it looks like I've lost this half. So what I'm going to show, or at least I'm not going to show it. I mean, I'm going to show why I don't care about it. Is what happens with this thing. So as I said, here with this function, many strings get the same hash. That is called the collision. Two different strings that hash to the same value, it's called the collision. Because I will compare them to be equal, when in fact, if I compare the original strings, I would say these two are equal. But instead, I have this. So this is called the collision. And you don't want collisions because they confuse you. I mean, are they equal or are they not? I cannot do this because this is slow. And if I do this, I get the wrong answer. Okay, so why am I not going to care about collision? So let's do a simple calculation. Let's say, for instance, I want to take this event small enough to fit in my computer, but big because there's no need to take it like 10. Let's take M. From now on, I work with M here to the 64. That will allow me in my program to think of a hash as an unsigned unknown. So, because the hash would be 0 to the 63 minus 1. So I can actually write this like the
there, sees, have you found the collision? If you have found, you have a problem,
you may test your program 1,000 times, and 999 times your program will be correct, find no problem. Maybe one time. So this thing here is why I'm going to not deal with collisions. I'm going to say collisions for me, they don't exist. If I work correctly. Okay? So I'm going to say the probability of having a collision is so small, I neglect it, and I work as if there are no collisions. Whenever I find the hash to be equal, I will say the probability of these two to be equal is extremely high, I will just assume it's one. Okay? Why is this? I mean, if you do the the other calculation is 10 strings of length L. You have k to the L possible strings. Take this over the number of hash paths or hashes you have. For L rather small, this gets, I mean, L100, this gets a lot. Really huge. So the number of strings that match to the same value is huge. But you cannot deal with huge numbers of strings. You will only be dealing with small numbers of strings. The chance for pairs of those small, those reduced number of strings to hash to the same thing is really small. You have a very long interval, and your hashes will go scattered around, and they will most of the time not connect. Okay? With this right. So this is the core of the topic today. I'm sort of drifting away over your ears, to correct algorithms and stuff that works 100% of the time. Running once, then it works, running twice, then it works, running 3 times, 10 times, 100 times, 1,000,000 times, it works exactly the same. So this is not like that. Okay? So this this is a different type of analysis. I'm working with a probabilistic algorithm. I'm saying the probability that this algorithm works, but rather low, I won't deal with them, okay? So, I hope this is not like a shock. I mean, after now, I mean, what comes next, nothing of what I'm going to say is right. There's no correct stuff I'm going to say ever again today. Because everything I'm going to say depends on this probability, and this is no, but it's not zero. Yeah.
Two questions. The first is, this is this low probability assuming you have a good function.
Yes, sir.
This probability is assuming we can get everything scattered.
Okay, assuming this is a uniform distribution, I think it's right. Yeah.
Okay, we will talk about how to get a good distribution.
I'm going to say, sort of, and I'm going to give you a concrete example that works really well.
Okay, and the other. The question is, if even choose like a good function, how difficult it is to build special cases to break that function?
I'm going to talk about that both in a, how to avoid people getting you. That's sort of the last part of the talk. And just for now, you can think this is a uniform distribution, and you cannot go back. You hash one thing, and then you get a number, and then if you want the collision with that, you cannot go back and see what other numbers hash to that. You have to try. You can only use this way. So you hash, you get something here, you cannot go back and see what other strings go there. And the problem is, if this is uniform, when you hash again, you try again, you get another number. How many times do you have to check? Well, you have to check the number of times that this order is to get a rather big probability of having a collision. So finding collisions is extremely, even if you check half of the, I mean, let's say this way, you have the range, you start putting dots, hash, strings you hash and you get there. In order to get a load just on above one that you already had, with probability 1/2, you probably have to hash half to have dots in half of the places. Okay? So when you're going to put the next dot, you want probability to be one half of going to some place it has already ended. You have to have tried half of the cases. So you have to have tried 10 to 9 times, which is rather large. Of course, this depends on this hashing contract being used. Okay.
For some reason, when people do hash functions, they usually choose a prime number.
Okay, so now I'm going to be more specific about I'm not choosing a prime number, right? Because this way, why I chose that, this way, all the moves are done internally in my computations. So this is more of a convenience than convenience in my calculations instead of going for a better hash map. I will try, given this end, I will try to see what happens or how can I improve my uniformity in other ways. I still have the choice for me, the value of each character and the best. Okay? So this is the reason. This is the reason I'm not going to deal with collisions. Okay? You have to be willing to accept this probability is low, but not zero. Yeah.
I could lose, for example, two hashes in my product using two different M's of primes in order to minimize the.
Okay, you can improve your hash function, for instance.
Yeah, because of the Chinese reminder error. I would have another M with one M of one.
Yeah, you can change this. This should be another hash function.
Yeah,
the probability of having two hash functions collide simultaneously will be this squared. So you're getting a lot better at avoiding collisions. So yes, there are a lot of ways to avoid collisions. I will talk about some of them, some tricks and some ways to avoid them later. So, good. Let me see. So, again, as I was saying, I'm willing to work with it because it's going to get my problems I see instead of one answer, which would be the normal, the correct. Answer by the judge if the judge has, I don't know, some kind of god that will try to implement them as they want it. They are not, they will try your program just once or twice, or as many times as test cases there are. This probability is low enough for me to get AC. Okay. I still have to fix some details. For instance, if I'm going to work with strings of different lengths and some character is zero, then collisions are going to be quite easy to get. If A has the value 0, then this still hashes to 0 and this still hashes to 0. Okay? So, one way of solving that is avoid comparing strings of different lengths. That's usually, I mean, this is not the job, that's usually possible. It's also nice because you're dealing with less strings, you're dealing with only strings of some given length at a time, and then you choose a different length, but you just erase every hash you had. So one way to avoid having this kind of problem is deal with strings of a given length, a fixed length at a time. If you're just not willing to do that, or you cannot do it because of your problem, then what you have to do is you have to encode the length somewhere around here. And an easy way to do that is just add the length. There. So I can just choose a constant here. I add it as a power to encode my length. And then this will have to do something different than this. And something different for different lengths, unless some very specific stuff happens that some power of C is the same as some other powers. Okay, so that would be
be a very, very specific case, maybe as specific as having two streams, but obviously not the same. Yeah.
Why not mapping instead of zero to k minus one?
Well, you can use another set of numbers, that's an answer. I just like this because it keeps my. You can take this or take it off, but turn it on or off rather easily. You can choose, you can also solve it by choosing different things. But there's no need. Usually this works. And the nice thing is you can calculate things as you would calculate. This would be, you can think of this as the hash or the value of the empty string. So the empty string is always before the thing, and you start adding characters, and each time you multiply. Sorry. This is not right. This is what I meant. You multiply it by the base. So the empty string is just C. When you get the character, it's just C times B and so on. Okay, so this would be the value of the empty string. I'm just adding a character. Essentially, it's the same thing as you said. I'm adding a character to my alphabet, which is the empty string. Okay? And it's always at the beginning of everything. Okay, so now we have to fix other problems. We already sort of fixed this configuration. Another problem I had was also pointed out. Calculating this hash function is still O(n). So I'm still having these two parts slow. I mean, I'm trying to avoid being slow here. I know how to be fast here. Now I'm truly fast. I mean, these are numbers. You comparing hashes is comparing on time domain, but so on. It's almost like the definition of one. But you have this to come to scope. And making this stuff fast is the key to really having a hash function that works. So how do I do this? Well, I have to realize in most problems I will not get just different strings. Okay? I will usually be working substrings of some string, or suffixes of some string, or prefixes, or something. Okay. So normally I will not get 10 to the 7 different strings. As I said, this would be a huge problem because I basically cannot read 10 to the 7 things unless they are really, really short. I may be dealing with 10 to the 7 substrings of some unique string, say of length 10,000 or something. Okay? So I may be dealing with a lot of substrings or some string. And then calculating the hash function can be sped up with some preprocessing. Okay? So the preprocessing I'm going to do is I'm going to calculate the hash function of the string up to a given place. Okay? So let's say I'm going to build an array that stores the hash function for the prefixes of my string. Good? So let's say I take h of 0 equal to 0. If I want to be careful, like that. If I wanted to take into account this C, I would just put it here. Okay, so this is a really easy change. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my string. Let's say bs is the size of my string. And I'm going to add this character to the next. Hash
get characters of my string. Okay? So that would be the hash of the first 10 characters. This is stopping it. Okay. Good. So what can I do with this? Well, let's say I wanted to calculate the hash. On my string in the range A, B. So from A to B, close, open, as you should work in interval. Okay? I want to calculate this. And I see that if I take H of B, what is H of B? It is the hash of all the characters up to B minus 1. Okay? So this hash hashes the characters in my string. So there's some character with A to X B minus 1. Okay? So this hash hashes all this. It has the part I want is here. Okay? It's the hash of this part. And this is an extra part I should subtract. So to subtract that, I should subtract. This is the hash. The previous character here is a minus 1. The hash of A. This is the hash of all the characters from 0 to 8 minus 1. But the problem is, all these hashes, this hash, gets, each time I add a new character, gets multiplied by B. So, in H of B, this hash appears with B minus A. Okay? So in order to calculate the hash of this range, I need to do this calculation. Good? So what can I do? I will start, once in my program, I will start by calculating this. Okay? So I go something like the power of my base, 0 is just 1. And then for any equal to 1, I minor or less than some maximum power I will need, which is the maximum length of any string I'm going to consider. I will never need powers bigger than that. So we go like n plus plus power of I equals to power of I minus 1 times b. Right, so this pre-calculates all the powers. So now, power of something is just b to that. That's that. So I can do this. Power of b minus a. Okay? And this is just something I can. Like I put an asterisk here. I change this into code rather easily. I can define some hash function. Hash. A. B. Return. B.
You have to put one M in the hash.
Cannot. That they when you work to the minus.
The minus.
I would have to put it if I choose a left and retry it. But I'm choosing this and using unsigned dot code. So the mod is operating is performed by the computer internal. Okay? So that was the reason. Mod is a costly operation. It was division. I don't want to do it every time I calculate the hash. So this is why I choose N to be just
very special number. I choose my hash to be an unsigned protocol, and this operation is performed really, really fast. Okay. So yeah, effectively, let's start fixing some stuff. Effectively, I'm not putting this because I'm dealing with hashes that are unsigned protocols. I shouldn't have read. Keep in mind this moment. That's the thing that's making it work, but keep in mind you don't have to do it yourself. It's being done by some big operations so I don't know about you. Let's fix the hash function as was mentioned. You need to choose things right or it's not going to work. So one obvious thing is to not choose the same value for two different characters. That would defeat the purpose. I would not be able to distinguish those characters. It would be really easy to find collisions then. So B. So B of C, I use. Subtract A and it maps the A to 0, B to 1, Z to 25, and that's it. So this works nicely. What do I choose as B? Because I've relaxed my constraint of thinking this hash set as a number, no need to really take B equal to 26 if I'm dealing with an algorithm of 26 letters. I can take B whatever I like. Someone mentioned prime numbers are usually nice, and they are. So I'm going to take B equal to 30. Now someone has to say that's not the right number. Okay, so it's not the right number. I'm going to deal with B equal to 33 because it works even if it's not the right number. Do I have to fix anything else? I don't think so. So I fix B, and then I can choose this, obviously, depending on. I can choose this depending on the length of my algorithm. I should not choose some base for here that is less than the length of my character because that would make B have not be unique. So I will have more characters and multiply my base, they will collide. Okay. So C, what do you choose by C? My choice, this. And it looks like a right number, but I don't know it. And it works. Right. This is me. Whenever you read code and you see this, maybe I wrote it. If you see something, some other numbers, then maybe someone else. So adding these constants usually works. because now if these are zero, then this constant still doesn't need a length. The problem is I may have a base, but given to some power is one, and then those are numbers here and here. The order of B model is what gives me how often I will have collisions in here. So if B to some power, let's say B to the G, is one, I say B is order G mod M to 64, and that means when I have here, if I have B to the N or B to the N plus T, that's the same thing, and that will make collisions more broad. So I choose this and this. I never checked what's the order of 33 or something like that. But what I know is judges don't usually know. I'm using 33. So you would have to make me compare two very specific strings of two very specific lengths. And you have to know what the order of my base, what my mod would be. If I can hide that, then it will be very difficult for you to prepare in this case for me to have a collision. Okay? So right now I'm counting on people not knowing that I'm using this. Later on I will say what you can do if people will know what your hash function is. There are still ways through. Okay? But it's related to some number of theory. That's why this is not the best solution, but this is not the best hash function. So a real hash function is not easy. If I do this, I can compare them, and I will just assume it works just as nicely. Okay. Doesn't mean it works just as nicely. It means I assume. Let's give a bit more talk about this. What I mean by I assume this works is when I have a wrong answer, I assume it's a bug and it's not, I'm being really unlucky. If I'm assuming I'm really being unlucky, then I may assume I'm really lucky and go and play the lottery. Don't play the lottery. So I assume I'm a bad coder and not really unlucky. You may be really unlucky, you may get a collision, and that may be the problem in your code. I would just think of this. Okay. It's really, really important. So, what I'm showing you here is basically when you're dealing, for instance, with substrings of some string, you can do the calculation of the hash function in O1. This is O1. Okay? So, this is not slow enough. And I fixed, and I've done whatever. What I wanted in the beginning. If I can calculate the hash function rather fast, then this is fast, comparing is fast, comparing about is slow, I've done what I wanted to do. Notice that the fact that I used this type of hash function allowed me to do this calculation. So this thing I raised, let's try it again. Slow, but I'm going to cross it out. This crossing out depends on my hash function. There are many other hash functions. This hash function uses plus and times operations. These are operations that are rather fast in my computer, and they allow me to do this type of calculation. There are hash functions that use, for instance, SOR or other or multiplications and SOR. When you use them, you have also fast calculation because those operations are easy, but you may lose something like this. And subtracting stuff is not that easy. Or maybe it's depending on how you use it or in that case, you should find a way to do calculations of your hash function fast. Okay? So this is why I say this is not a real hash function. The hash function you use other security related places would not have this kind of property. They would have some better security because they are meant for our computer. This hash function is meant for me to be able to do this fast. Okay? So I calculate any substring, it's hash, I can calculate any normal.
So this is all preparation for what I can do with all this.
Just being able to know if two strings are equal or are, right?
For now, I am.
Okay. So are you going to go further?
I am. Yeah, so for now, it looks a bit, if you put it that way, it looks a bit small, right? I spent like an hour to compare two strings. You know what? I mean, I compare two strings in all. So comparing them, they are equal. So it looks small. But as I said, you relax something, you find new ways, new flexibility in your tools, the tools have more power. Right now my power is this. And what I'm going to do now is push what I can do with that. I will push on the way I can. Okay? Frankly, by the end of today, I will have shown that I can push quite a bit. Okay? Or at least for me, for example, I can solve some problems. I wouldn't get So, what can I do if I now know how to compare two strings in one? So, one thing I can do is reduce the overhead I would have in a lot of algorithms. For instance, a very easy problem, say, like if this statement is very short, find the longest common substring of two strings. That will be faster. Find the longest repeated substring in a string. That will be faster. Okay. So, for instance, let's think about this last problem. The longest repeated substring in a string. So you can just hash strings of the same length, put them in a map. Whenever you find that your map already has that hash, you know that the string is repeated. Okay, so you can hash all the substrings of the string and put them in a map, and that would be x squared instead of to the cube if you want to compare them to the graph. Okay, so you're peeling off some coherence in your arguments. Yeah. So checking for strings being palindromes. The palindrome is the string that goes the same this way and that way. So one way to check for if strings are palindromes is you can perform this hash, this precalculation. One way you can perform the same precalculation, if this would be the direct way, you need to perform the same calculation the reverse way, and your string going the other way around. And then you can calculate the hash of the string going this way and this way. So what you have to check is given a center. So
sorry, the problem was the string is palindrome.
Yeah, checking if it's palindrome. That would be normally open, right?
Yeah, this way it's also open, right?
No. Okay, let's say I want to check which substrings of the string are palindrome. Let's say I give it words. I give you an original string. And I give you queries. Is this range a palindrome? Yeah, I'm dealing with smaller problems right now because I'm thinking I'm going to repeat them rather many times. Okay. So let's say I give you a longer string and I give you substrings of it, and I want to check if they are palindrome. Normally, you have to go all the way and check if each character matches the character that is symmetric to the other side.
They're kind of reducing the U to a square.
Okay, but that would be again being on it. Of course, I can use a specific algorithm to find the palindrome, but I want to use a very generic one, which is just use hash. So, if I have something that calculates the hash direct, so a direct hash like this, and I have the similar precalculation performed the other way around, meaning from the end to the beginning. What I can do to check if a palindrome is just calculate the direct hash from the start, say, from the middle, and then from the start very, this is simple code in a sense. I have not shown you how to write it, but you should think about it, and you should be extra careful with the indices here, because this is all the image. So if you're careful about this, you can do this in a way. And being careful is not just putting some extra okay, so you can check if the screen is palindrome in O1, and that will allow you to make a lot of algorithms faster. So right now I'm just using this thing that seemed to be not so much, but it already helps in a lot of problems. What would be more helpful is to be actually able to compare stuff. This is just comparing the variables. I would like to know if something is lower or greater than, some string is lower or greater than another. So that was open, and I said I've lost it because my hash function is not 1:1. Okay, so I'm going to try to recover it or recover some part of it. And the way to do that is to do a binary search on the number of characters two strings that are the same. So let's say I want to find the longest common prefix of two suffixes of a string. Okay? That's a normal nice problem. Let's say I have this.
Well, for sure we have the same kind of representation of the hash because the node
So what? So, so
OM.
Sorry?
OM.
O one. The pre-calculation I did it once. And then remember I stored everything in my array.
Okay.
You remember this calipatch only uses one lookup in my array and one multiplication and one subtraction. Sorry, three lookups, one multiplication, one subtraction. Okay. Remember the goal. So this is just O1. Everything I'm going to do is based this being O1. Okay? So yeah, you have to have an O1 pre-calculation. This is so I brought this O and pre-calculation. Okay? So once I do this, I can compare two prefixes, sorry, two suffixes by using this. So to compare the suffix that starts at A1 and the suffix that starts at A2. How do I compare? I just take a temporary variable becomes an identity B of A1, A2, and then I return. And I have to check if the next character is smaller or greater. But in there are TFP characters that are the same. So I have to check if the next character is the same one. So I just return my string in A1.TFP. If less, I miss. Okay, so now this is a comparison. Okay, so I said I had comparison in O1 and it didn't work. I lost some constraint. I now get only this in O1, and now I get comparison in log-n, which is a lot. I mean, it's a lot better than O(n) or log-n. It's almost like now. And it's a very, very, very efficient binary search. Right? No weird campaign. So I'm starting to get more power. Okay? So I can do this. Let's start recording. I can do this. Now I can do this. Okay. What can I do now? I can do anything that needs comparing. For instance,
so here you're taking the values of a letter. You're comparing values of a letter.
Yeah. So I know the hashes are the same up to a certain point. Okay, so the strings are the same at the certain point. The next character decides if one string is less or greater than the other. Okay, that's great. Because only one character decides. So, one thing you can do with suffixes and prefixes is suffix arrays, you know? One way of doing stuff really, really fast using strings is using suffix arrays. I'm showing another way, but I can show you that this way you can build a suffix array if you ever feel like it. So this is how you build a suffix array. You basically let's suppose you have an array. That's it. So that's my suffix array. There's two line implementation. I ever worked in my LCP array, so this that way.
You may want to speed up a map
plot, you create a vector. And that vector can be pairs of hashes and whatever you like. For instance, int. Let's say you want to fill up a map that goes that takes hashes to int. So you create a vector and value v and put here some max index that's reasonable again. Maybe a bit. It should probably be of the order of the number of stuff you're going to put there. So normally you wouldn't put more than a million of things on your map or something. Or if you're going to put 10 million, then just take this 1 million or whatever. But so if this is big, that's nice. So what you're going to do is when you're putting something in this map, you're going to put it in the position referred by a special index, which is the hash. So the insertion is just v of edx push back main pair. Your hash, a full hash here, not just the index, a full hash, and the value we want to put for now. Okay, so whenever you need to retrieve something, and let's say I want to get the integer that belongs to some hash.
So is the hash the assignment node, or?
Hash is an assignment node. But this is a pair. There, assignment node, integer, or string, or whatever you want. The second part is not going to get it. Just the value you're going to get. So, if you want to retrieve the value, you calculate for a given hash, you calculate the index, you go to this place, and you go from the beginning to the end of this vector, seeing if some of the pairs has the first element, the hash you want. What's the running time of that? If I have this, the order of the number of hashes I'm going to put, I remember the hashes are uniformly distributed. But as I do this, they are again uniformly distributed. The number of hashes per value of the index is going to be O1. Okay? So with putting things and retrieving things is O1 in this kind of map. Because the number of elements that go to each index is O1. So this speeds up nicely maps when you are working with hashes. Okay, you use the hash as an index. That's one trick. Something someone mentioned is how do I prepare for someone who is really bad guy and he wants to in my hash function using relations. So, as I said, I sort of depend on people not knowing my hash function. So now, I'm going to give you one. if you know the hash function, you know, or you could at least in theory prepare some test cases. Think top coder, for instance. You're competing in top coder, someone looks at your code, knows your hash function, and may want to challenge you. It may have, in those 15 minutes, it may have enough time to find the collision and feed it to your program. You don't want that. So one way to avoid that is to hide your hash function even from yourself. Let's say I don't know my own hash function. Okay? So how do I do that? I randomize the values in my hash function. Okay? So one way to hide the hash function from everyone, including yourself, is just take an array of bases, whatever, say 5, 33, 37, 41, 72.
time your program runs, it wanna run at random. Okay, let's say some guy went out and found a collision for your base 33 hash. Most likely that collision will not be the collision when you take 37 as a base. So that guy will have a priority, let's say 5, then 4. So that guy has a 25% chance of hitting it. So if he has the calculation of the expected number of points he needs, he won't charge. Right? And you can go even further. I mean, you randomize just the base you choose. You can simply randomize the values you choose. Let's say that the guy counted on you choosing A0, B1, C. Like he prepared the stream and knew what the hash is going to be. Right? So maybe what you can do is take B of C as C minus A. So when you're calculating values, you look them up in this array, but before your program, shuffle. So this was this had all the numbers from 0 to 25, shuffle them, it's a permutation. So what's the chance of it hitting you? So this gets you an extra 1 over 25 factorial. So that's the number of expected points before you're using code. Okay? Of course, you can also randomize the constant variation. So you can randomize the elements of your hash function, and that will sort of hide the hash function from you and from everyone else. Nobody knows which hash function is going to work with each test case or anything. Okay? So, yes, sir? I've heard people say no, you can't use that because they know. Like, if someone read my code, then they know what I use and they have some condition prepared for my hash function. I can randomize it, but then it's going to have a hard time.
But can you see yourself as some non-deterministic code or
like a no way, I've never used this in the code. I don't usually put this in the code. For me, I usually do. Could take something from your input process and makes life harder to play. Okay. So yeah, I've never seen this used before. I'm just saying, if you are in some sort of setting where the judge is able to see your code and act upon your code, then this is one way to confuse him. Great. Another trick is you can calculate the hash of a concatenation of the same string really fast. So that's nice. Let's say you have a string A and you think A squared is just take A and concatenate with A. Okay? Can you calculate the hash function of A squared? How long will it take? It takes a while. You just take the hash of A, multiply it by the power of the length of A, the power of the base to the length of A, and add the hash of A again. Once you've realized you can square in O1, can you get, what can you do to get A to the L power? I mean, L concatenations of your string. You can do it in OL, obviously. Just go ahead and repeat this L times. But you can be better and take this, OL, using points. Remember points, I talked about it first day. You basically take the power, write it in binary, and start squaring and doing your calculation as I don't. So you just It's basically bullets, but you just have to keep track of the length of your string. Okay? So you can find the track of the concatenation of your string. That would be rather useful.
Thank you.
starts facing the notice yesterday. Now I can talk about strings. And think about yesterday, and yesterday you had Kina is not under an abbreviation. That problem can be solved with hash. And maps and some good people. You also had another problem for strings, which was Fibonacci words in the word final, that can also be solved with hashing. And because of the time, I think I'll probably go with Fibonacci words. Maybe if I have something, I may say something about it. Okay, good. To see an application. So, if you remember Fibonacci words, so any questions about the theory part of it? Do you feel this is work? Did you know this before? The ones who heard me, they probably knew it by heart. I mean, I hope I refreshed did anyone who had not heard me last year, do you know? Or did you know all this stuff? Do you think part of it? Yeah? Okay, so I hope, at least, I think maybe some people know about hashing. They may not know some of the trickier things, like getting a suffix array or something. Some people just think how to calculate numbers and compare. It's a bit more. You can get rather far. So, if you knew about it, then maybe I can show you one or two tricks you can use. Let's give a more. Raise your hand, whoever has solved a problem using hashing. Okay. Quite a few. So those of you who were last year, or, yeah. So try to solve, once you've solved some one problem with hashing, that's my goal. The next one should be the harder. So try to solve harder problems with hashing and see what happens. Sometimes you can be surprised of how easy solutions are coming. Of course, I didn't say it, but I mentioned it. Most of the stuff you can probably do it with other structures. The dynamic part of the algorithm, taking an algorithm and making it dynamic, just adding a login. I don't know similar stuff for suffix arrays or tries. I guess there are. Probably something won't work in dynamic tries or something for race. But that's a nice thing, although I've never seen it in a problem other than my problem because it's there. So, I don't know how to use that kind of thing.
Solve this problem, now I have to implement that.
Of course, I'm merging with Fibonacci, so it's going to involve some DB.
It wouldn't be right otherwise.
So I can have an array. I can talk a bit about DB for those. You probably don't know this, but whatever. I have an array, and I want to just fill my array. Count of n will be just the number of times my pattern appears in a vector. To fill this array, I'm going to use this function. This could be a lot of array. Or whatever. I'm just going to skip the DB part. Yeah, it could be enough. We were assured this was this fit inside the dogma. So let's put here the maximum n I want. And what I'm going to use is the demonstration to fit this array. Okay? So I demoize my results. Let's say I fill this with zero is a possible result, so I let's fill this to minus one. So if it's minus one, then I have not solved this problem before. If I do something, and when I return, I fill my cat. This is just a standard memorization structure. If I have not calculated something before, I calculate it, fill it in a matrix, in an array, and then if I have already calculated it, I return. Okay? So what should I do here? I should start by saying count of n is equal to, I call my function whenever I want to access this array, I call my function. As always, n minus 1. Plus count of n minus 2. It is here every time it appears in the first half or in the second half. In the first part or the second part. Okay? So now I'm only missing the part where I calculate those that are in between. That's part of some place. Some part of this and some part of this. Of course, before doing this, I should put some boundary conditions. For instance, if the length of f of n is smaller than b, then return 0. For instance, right? Here I will store the length of f of n. If this is smaller than the length of my pattern, then there's no worries about that there. This should also be like if n is negative, I can go there. So in case sometimes I have a problem there. I have to be extra careful just to make sure. This length, if you look at this, the length of this is 1, the length of this is 1, the length of this is 2, and the length is just Fibonacci numbers. You can pre-calculate it, of course, because n could go up to 100, those Fibonacci numbers will get too big soon enough. But what you have to do is calculate the first part, the first of it. You will always be comparing the length to the length of your pattern. So calculate the first few of them until you get over the length. Maximum possible length of the pattern, then put for every length of every next Fibonacci, just put some value representing the sigma, some very big value. Then to the ninth model. Then your Fibonacci will always be larger than your pattern. So using hashes, what you can do also is you can calculate the hash of the n Fibonacci string, right? So let's assign this character some value, whatever, 5. This character another value, 3. Good, so this is deeply hashed to 5, deeply hashed to 3. The hash of this can be calculated in some place, whatever you like, 13. You can change your number. You can calculate it using the same stuff I've been talking about. Again, you will not be able to calculate, or I mean, but you will calculate all the hashes of all the Fibonacci words. There's really no need, because you will only have to compare hashes with hashes for your quantum key. So you should calculate the first. You can probably stop calculating at 32 Fibonacci words, and then you never need more hashes than that. Okay, so this might go into assume all around, and I have some length of n, which is the Fibonacci number, and the hash of n, which is the recalculation of the hash of the n Fibonacci. Then this is two lines. So once I've done that, I can also check, for instance, if the length. Is equal to b, then you can return. You can also calculate, you should, the hash of your. Half recalculation of the cumulative hashes, the same recalculation as from a finished half for your pattern. So this is return base key of B is equal to. If the two have the same length, they should be equal. Or else there's no current, then return the whole hash of your pattern should be equal to the hash of your Fibonacci. So I think that covers special cases and will avoid my negotiation to be problematic. So now I can concentrate on doing the time inferences, it appears, the pattern appears here. So I just go on a 4, n was 100, so, and my pattern was 100,000, I think. So you can basically, for each time you calculate this, because you're going to calculate it once, and then store its value, you can go through all your patterns. So I'm going to take I from 1 to t minus 1, and then I plus plus. And I'm going to think I have I characters of my pattern in the left part and p minus I characters in the right part. Okay? So what I should do is calculate the hash of the part of the left, the part that comes from here, calculate the hash of the part that comes from there, stitch them together, and then see if that hash is equal to the hash of my pattern. Okay? So if I will use this to calculate the hash of the last characters of the last characters of a Fibonacci word. I mean, it has the underscore because I'm going to memorize it also. Okay? So, I want the last I characters of n minus 1. And I should add to that the hash of the. I'm going to do it the other way. The rightmost characters, the rightmost I characters of n minus 1. And the leftmost t minus I characters of n minus 2. So I have my f of n. I can think of it some string that is part of some place, I'm thinking about taking I characters here and my design characters there and seeing if my pattern matches this stuff. So this, the hash of this will be the rightmost characters of n minus 1, so this is n minus 1, this is n minus 2. But the sizes are wrong. This is that. And that is the leftmost character, the characters on the left. There are prime and prime characters. And it's n minus. Okay? And to join the two, I have to multiply by the base, the power. So there are p minus I characters here. When I put this string together with this one, the hash of this part gets multiplied by the power of the base to the power of p minus I, the number of characters here. So if this is true, just go count. Okay, that's that. And this is the main function in my solution. Okay? So now I have to do this and this. So let's do one of them. Let's do whatever. So I want the talk to a candidate. I should have some, I should go into memory, so I should have some array. Like that. Okay. And I'm going to memoize this, so I'm going to build a function for hash r in the length. So the number of characters I want to take from the right part of Fibonacci element. So what should I do? Here, before, so these were subjects that went here. say if I have calculated or not some position, because I cannot fill it with minus ones, because these are hashes and all the possible values are, I can store it here, maybe a hash. So I cannot say this corresponds to, I have not calculated some. So this is just an array pool telling me which values are here I have calculated and which I have not. Okay, whenever I calculate stuff, after I finish, very good. VR of that and equals true. And then I will never calculate that value again. So how do I calculate that? Basically what I have is I have a Fibonacci word. I want to calculate the hash of some value. And I have two options. That part either includes all the rightmost part and the part of the leftmost part, where I can split this in two and can include everything here and some part of here, or just some part of here. So if the length that I'm going to compute is less than the length, you're probably the last few test cases, you're probably just using values. Okay? So, this is my solution. It's pretty directly from my token.
Now this graph is very special because
each chemical has another chemical and only one that you cannot mix with. So each node should have an edge. There are energies and nodes, and basically that means the graph will be almost the tree. Okay, so by almost the tree, I mean you may have some cycle, but you can only have just one cycle, right? There's only one chance, just one extra edge. As well as a cycle, you can have some legs. I call them legs. Like, they look like this. And what you can, why I said this is almost a tree? It's almost a tree because if you compress this cycle, like you transform it into one thing, it becomes a tree. So, what you have to do is you have to color this graph. And the way to color it is, well, because we have a cycle, we should first think about the cycle. Okay? If I have already colored the cycle, let's give numbers to colors. So let's say I have 1, 2, 1, 3. Once I have already colored my cycle, this is a valid color, not too nearby nodes have the same color. Coloring the legs is rather straightforward. Because once I have the three here I can put any color that's not the three. So I have k minus one choices. And here I have any color that's not here, k minus one choices. So the number of colorings gets multiplied by k minus one each time I have a node that does not belong to the cycle. Okay? So how do I calculate the number of ways which you can in which you can color a cycle? Because I multiply that number. So I know my answer, my result, we get number of nodes. What I can do is think, okay, so how many times am I overcounting? I am overcounting, that's number of nodes like this. This is node 0, this is node 1, this is node 2, this is node 3. These are the number of ways to color all of them, but I am overcounting. I am overcounting by the number of ways these two have the same color. For the first one, I can choose any color. For the next one, I have to choose a color different than the previous. I am overcounting by the number of times the last one ends up with the same color as the first one. To count them is really easy if you observe that you can join them. If this one has the same color as this one, you can think of this as a binary coloring of a graph with one, of a cycle with one node test. So I join them, and this, if I join them, this would be a binary coloring with k colors and n minus 1 nodes. So I just subtract the color n minus 1. Okay. Obviously, I need some boundary conditions here. For instance, the number of coloring of k colors of two nodes, which is k minus 1. Well, this is inclusion exclusion, right? So I count and then I subtract and then I count. This is the region. Okay. Did you solve it this way?
Thank you.